Hello, I'm Tony Truelove and I will be your moderator for today's webinar. Welcome to the fifth webinar in our Engage the Expert series. This series of webinars was designed to give you more insight into diesel cylinder deactivation, which we feel is a key to achieving future diesel emissions regulations. Each webinar delved into various aspects of cylinder deactivation, or CDA for short. We're going to switch up the batting order today and lead off with our technical presentation. After that, our experts will be available to take your questions, so feel free to send us questions as you're listening to the keynote presentation. Our guest speaker will then give his thoughts on this webinar series and Eaton's involvement with cylinder deactivation. And just as a reminder, we had five webinars in this series, starting back at the beginning of September, where we talked about the truth about diesel CDA and NVH. We looked at how the CDA could achieve 2027 emissions. We looked at how CDA performed over real-world drive cycles. And then last week, we looked at, you know, a deeper level of diesel cylinder deactivation. So this week, the title of the webinar is CDA versus Cylinder Cutout, a Technology Overview. And Dr. Cody Allen is our keynote presenter here. But I'm first going to lead off with our panelists. And first up is Dr. Greg Shaver. Dr. Shaver is a professor at Purdue, and Dr. Shaver's been with us on three of these webinars in the series, I believe, so you're probably familiar with his accomplishments. So Dr. Shaver, let's jump into it here. You've had a number of excellent student presentations in this series, and today is another one of those. So can you tell us how you recruit and develop these students at Purdue as they are clearly excelling in this area?
Thank you, Tony. I'd be delighted to speak to that. I think it starts with, you know, Purdue and Purdue Engineering, Purdue Mechanical Engineering, you know, being an academic program at both the undergraduate and graduate level that a lot of talented students are attracted to. So that is one of probably the first moon to align for me, if you will. The other is, you know, there's a lot of hard, relevant, interesting problems to work with industry on. And those are the types of problems, particularly in the commercial vehicle, powertrain, and partial autonomy space that I'm very interested in. And so the other thing that the second moon that's aligned, I guess you'd say, with regard to being able to recruit and train and push out into the real world, you know, great students, is my work with industry. So all of my projects currently, and in the vast majority of all the projects I've worked on since I joined the Purdue faculty in 2006, have included industry. So all of my projects right now are collaborations with industry. About half of them, a little bit more than half of the funding comes from industry. The other half comes from the government, for instance, the Department of Energy. So that engagement with industry allows us to kind of sharpen our focus on some of the bigger challenges that the industry is facing, and the students really enjoy that. It also means that the students have an opportunity to present not just to themselves and to me, but also to and with their industry partners, and that keeps all of them and me and my faculty colleagues on our toes, and that's really been an outstanding thing. The last thing I'll say is that related to that is our industry partners, including Dr. McCarthy, Jim McCarthy, who's on the panel today, they help me mentor the students. So the students don't just have to rely on what I know or what they know, but also they're able to lean on our partners, our collaborators, including folks like Jim and colleagues and friends we have at other industry partner companies too, as well as other faculty members that I work with and other staff at Purdue. So I've been able to build like a dream team of not only students, but of other folks that help me recruit and train and work with these students. And I think that makes all the difference. So thank you, Tony, for the question.
Sure, no worries, and perfect segue here. So our next panelist is Dr. Jim McCarthy, as Greg just referred to. Jim is Chief Engineer for Vehicle Technologies here at the Eaton Vehicle Group. And Jim, you've been on all these, so you know how the next thing goes here. So tell us about a couple of the projects that our keynote speaker, Dr. Cody Allen, led at Purdue and the impact that it had on the research.
Yeah, thanks, Tony. And let me just add to Greg's comment there. Wow. I mean, definitely is a dream team. I mean, the amount of quality students that Greg brought on were incredible. So I'll get to my question now. It was exciting working with Greg, Cody, and the entire team at Purdue. And for many of our projects, we would come up with hypotheses. And Greg said it was very interactive, and it certainly was. We explored the merits with testing and simulation. Then the students would program the control system such that the results could be realized on the engine and after-treatment system. I remember one of the projects with Cody where he investigated various methods of entering CDA and its effect on cylinder pressure and fuel economy. The results were a little surprising at first. However, detailed analysis showed that it all made sense. Next, Cody was instrumental in the transient controls moving from CDA to normal operation while meeting all the engine torque demands. That strategy is in practice today. Another project is cylinder cutout, which is the topic of today. And this would have been an easy implementation for OEM since it didn't require any variable valve operation. However, we found significant fuel savings with CDA over cylinder cutout, which Cody will share today. Plus, there are many proposals for improving brake thermal efficiency in industry by replacing the variable geometry turbo to a high efficiency turbocharger. And it was exciting to see the separation of fuel savings with CDA over cylinder cutout when we changed the turbocharger. And Cody will explain why this happened. Definitely the impact of the research was significant, and we took the best strategies and implemented these in the final calibration. And these calibrations were used for transient operations, many of which have been touched on the previous webinars. I can say that Cody is a very talented engineer who excelled at Purdue, went to Boeing and excelled, and is now a professor at the University of Illinois. I am sure that you will enjoy his talk today. Thanks, Tony.
Thank you, Jim. And without further ado, let's introduce you to our keynote speaker, Dr. Cody Allen. Dr. Allen is an assistant professor at the University of Illinois, and as you probably heard, he was at Purdue for his master's and bachelor's. So Dr. Allen's research focuses on creating cleaner, more efficient, heavy-duty vehicles by exploring advanced powertrain technologies and architectures. So Dr. Allen, without further ado, why don't you go ahead and take over here? Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for the intro, Tony and Jim. Today we're going to discuss CDA versus cylinder cutout and do a little bit of a comparison, a technology overview, if you will. Well, CDA is a technology, cylinder cutout is more of a strategy probably. But the work here was based on a collaboration between Purdue, Eaton, and Cummins at Purdue University, and the PI was Dr. Shaver, who you just heard from. So I was a part of this during my graduate work at Purdue. Before we discuss any results, let's just jump right to the experimental setup at Purdue. So this is the Cummins Power Lab. It houses a Cummins inline six-cylinder camless diesel engine. You see boxed in yellow there. It's a modern engine, modern actuators, high-pressure EGR, variable geometry turbine, turbocharger. Both of those will be, key later during our results, and a modern fuel system. The highlight of the test bed, right, so the camless part of that diesel engine comes from a fully flexible electrohydraulic VVA system. The system allows cylinder to cylinder and cycle by cycle control of the valve events, for all of the cylinders, intake and exhaust. Along with this, we have an open ECM architecture allowing us cycle by cycle control of the engine calibration levers with the on-engine actuators, and so combined we can look at the optimal solution for various VVA strategies. In this case today, what we're going to talk about being CDA. Downstream of the engine, we have a modern aftertreatment system, a DOC, DPF, SDR system, 2010 emissions compliant. We won't talk a whole lot today about aftertreatment output results, but it's there and it's in a lot of the prior work as well. And then it's a very modern test cell with complete emissions bench, temperatures in cylinder and engine pressures, flow rates, all that good stuff. So cylinder deactivation, what are we talking about? All there on the right, you see a little cartoon of cylinders 1, 2, 3 being deactivated and cylinders 4, 5, 6 remaining active. That cartoon will be used throughout the presentation. You get to, hopefully, it's simplistic, but I think it gets the picture across of what we're talking about. So in the deactivated cylinders, so in cylinders 1, 2, 3 in this case, the valve motion would be suspended and the fueling would be suspended. So then in the remaining cylinders, 4, 5, 6 in this case, the fueling would need to be increased in order to maintain torque. So in this 3-cylinder active operation, we cut out or we deactivated half of the cylinders. So the fueling would need to increase roughly 2 times in the active cylinders. So that's cylinder deactivation. At the risk of oversimplifying it with plots, we want to take those deactivated cylinders from an active state, the valve profiles that you see on the left, and deactivate them within the cycle. So you see we had profiles in the active cylinders there on the left, and now we don't have any profiles on the right. And that there's, you know, this, when you show it like this, it does oversimplify it because there's a number of different ways you can make that activation happen. And we studied that. There particularly a couple different types of trapping strategies, fresh charge trapping and combustion charge trapping. Fresh charge trapping being where you trap fresh charge and the freshly inducted charge in the cylinder. So you deactivate the cylinder after the intake stroke, versus combustion charge trapping where you actually trap combusted exhaust gas in the cylinder. So basically you deactivate the cylinder after that last fuel injection and you don't exhaust out the combusted gases. You know, ideally you have a perfect gas spring in the deactivated cylinders either way, but there are losses. And actually those losses we've shown minimize the differences between the trapping strategies. So the cylinder pressures converge after only a few cycles for fresh charge trapping and combustion charge trapping after the deactivation. And you can see that here, and we study that in quite a bit of depth. So regardless of how you get into the deactivated cylinder mode, once you're there, the typical results are improvement at low loads and stay warm thermal management performance via reduced exhaust flow and elevated exhaust temperatures, fuel efficiency improvements via reduced pumping work, and engine out emissions. Slides are a little messed up on my screen. I hope they're not. Hope they're in order on yours. But let's get to some results. We'll start off by setting up our baseline, and all the results today I'm going to show you are at curb idle. So for this particular engine, it is 800 RPM, 1.3 bar BMEP. The layout of this slide will carry throughout the presentation, so let's go through it. In the top left, you see a scatter plot of turbine outlet temperature and brake-specific fuel consumption normalized to this TM baseline point, okay? Below that, you see normalized exhaust flow rates. We know, you know, when you're talking about thermal management, that has to do with exhaust flow rate and turbine outlet temperatures, so it's always important to consider both. And then on the right, you just see the cartoon about what the engine's doing for the points that I'm showing there, or the new points that I'm showing there. The points themselves, there's two of them there. The first one, and at the lower turbine outlet temperature, is our FE6CF, so, you know, fuel efficient six-cylinder firing. That's what that stands for. It's just the conventional fuel efficient mode of the engine, so that calibration. These are both just conventional calibrations for the engine. By delaying the injections and closing the VGT, we can transition to this TM baseline or thermal management baseline. And in doing so, we get markedly higher turbine outlet temperatures, so 120 degrees Celsius, at the expense of 50% plus more fuel consumption, and also comes with it elevated exhaust flow rate. So this is what the stock engine is doing. This is the state-of-the-art thermal management calibration strategy. So that's why we're putting that as our baseline. So you'll see most things today normalize to that TM baseline, that state-of-the-art thermal management calibration. How does CDA stack up here? I'll add 2 points here that are both three-cylinder active operation. One of the points has cylinders 1, 2, 3 active. One of the points has cylinders 4, 5, 6 active. So again, in the deactivated cylinders, the valve and the fueling is suspended. In doing so, you can see we get elevated exhaust temperatures over that fuel-efficient 6CF operation. Not quite as high as the thermal management baseline, but still elevated. But we are at 40% or over 40% fuel savings past that thermal management baseline strategy. So we get elevated exhaust temperatures and reduced fuel consumption. We also get, and not to belittle this point, we get reduced exhaust flow rates. So down there in that bottom plot, you can see the bars on the bar graph. The exhaust flow rate by cutting aft cylinders, it cuts the exhaust flow rate in roughly half, right? And that has a big impact on stay warm thermal management performance. By deactivating an additional cylinder, the results get even better for CDA. So I've added another plot or another point here, and this is cylinders 3 and 4 active, so only 2 cylinders firing. Here we're maintaining 40% fuel savings over thermal management baseline at actually a little bit higher turbine outlet temperature, but so roughly equivalent turbine outlet temperature of greater than 250 degrees Celsius at that reduced exhaust flow rate. So, you know, a question is are we constrained on emissions? And the answer is yes. If you look there on the right, you can see a grayed out box of particulate matter on the x-axis and on the y-axis and NOx on the x-axis. And we're within the box. So we're constrained compared to TM baseline for both cases. We're not only constrained, but when it comes to particularly particulate matter, we're at markedly lower particulate matter. CDA shows markedly lower particulate matter than the thermal management baseline strategy. So the combination of all of these together is why CDA is an attractive stay warm thermal management strategy to maintain the aftertreatment temperatures, maintain elevated aftertreatment temperatures after they're hot. So your aftertreatment is performing effectively. And there's a number of different ways to, you know, quantify how effective it is. And one of them is to just run these points on the drive cycle. And you've seen some of, you know, an HDFTP, for instance, and you've seen that being demonstrated by some of the previous webinars in this webinar series. And I think the results are pretty compelling. Another way of looking at a single operating condition is to just do a step change. We like step changes in engineering, right? So this would be a step change in this case from highway cruise. So before the zero time on this axis, on the x-axis is you're in steady state highway cruise. The aft treatment is warm. It's at steady state, and then a step change to curb idle and see how the after treatment cools off. And so this is another way where we looked at analyzing the stay warm performance of CDA. And there's your SCR outlet temperature, so at the very very end of your after treatment system, and you can see that CDA with two cylinders firing maintains elevated SCR outlet temperatures for greater than 34 minutes over that thermal management baseline TM6CF strategy. For 34 minutes. And that's important because you can see on that plot on the right that the NOx conversion efficiency is very dependent on SCR catalyst temperature. And it maintains that SCR outlet temperature advantage while using 38% less fuel. So that's the kicker. It's fuel efficient thermal management strategy along with reduced emissions. So if you're interested in more, there's a journal publication about this where we go through the whole after treatment system and see how this affects it. Some interesting insights come out of these step changes. Yet another way of going about this is more analytical. Based off of the steady state data, you can do a lumped catalyst heat transfer analysis. We know that the heat transfer rate to the catalyst is proportional to our exhaust flow rate to the 4/5 multiplied by the temperature difference between your exhaust and your catalyst. And so with that, you can normalize everything to, in this case, TM baseline that gets rid of any sort of variation in the aftertreatment and get a heat transfer rate. So that's what's on the y-axis versus for various catalyst temperatures. So here you just have, this is for 800 RPM, 1.3 bar curb idle. So the goal here is to be as, this is just for thermal management, the goal is to be as positive as possible. So you want to go up. If you're to the left, if you're positive exhaust heat transfer, so you're above that zero line, you're warming up the after treatment. If you're below it, you're cooling off the after treatment, but you want to cool it off as little as possible, right, in order to keep it warm. And so in this case, TM baseline is better for both warm-up and stay-warm operation than FE6CF for, you know, the all catalyst temperatures until you see at the very bottom right, they start to cross over maybe at 470 Celsius. So this isn't too interesting, but whenever you throw on CDA points, things become more interesting because CDA, this clearly shows, you know, we're looking at the right hand over there, we are more positive for CDA operation. And that's really demonstrates CDA's improved stay warm performance over TM baseline. The thermal management baseline has better warm-up performance still, but CDA, when only implemented at idle operation at least, has better stay warm performance. So if you wanted to only focus on thermal management performance and 250 in this case was your magic catalyst temperature, this would be the strategy you would want to run, and you would save fuel in doing so, right? So you would stay in TM baseline during warm-up and then switch to CDA after the catalyst temperature is at your desired temperature in order to keep it warm. So to summarize what we've learned so far about CDA in a little simplistic table, you can see here we have a case of TM baseline, and then we have those CDA cases we discussed. We've got better stay warm performance for CDA, so it gets the green check marks on those compared to the baseline. It does not have better warm-up performance, at least when implemented only at idle, or only at normal idle, non-elevated speed idle. And it has lower fuel consumption, lower NOx, and lower PM. CDA has lower all of those variables versus TM baseline. And so that's one of the reasons why we like it. And the reason why this table is awkwardly positioned to the left of your screen is because we're going to fill it out the rest of the way with cylinder cutout, okay, and do this comparison. So cylinder cutout, as opposed to CDA, does not deactivate any valves. It only removes the fueling from the deactivated, or from the cutout cylinders. We'll call those cutout cylinders. So in the cutout cylinders, the fueling is suspended. In the remaining active cylinders, much like CDA, the fueling must be increased to maintain torque. Okay, and then the net result of that is, well, it depends. And I'm not trying to be a smart aleck or anything. It actually does depend, and I'll show you why it depends. It depends because of the architecture of our particular engine, okay? And so these are simplistic cartoons, but they tell some important details. So here on the left, you see cylinder cutout with 4, 5, 6 active, and on the right, you see cylinder cutout with 1, 2, 3 active. In each case, all the cylinders are still pumping gas, but there's only combustion happening in half of them, right? If you notice, the exhaust manifold in these plots is shown as being split into two, right? The 1, 2, 3 is in a bank and 4, 5, 6 is in a bank. And that's accurate representation of the actual engine. The exhaust manifolds it's a split exhaust manifold. And if you also notice, the EGR loop pulls off of right around cylinder 6. And so it only really pulls off of one of the exhaust manifold banks. And this is important when you're considering cylinder cutout, because your EGR flow is going to be a mixture of just the air, the gas pumped cylinders and that combustion gas, and how close that EGR loop is to the actual combusting cylinders changes the type of EGR that it gets. So this is an important note. So let's populate the slides that I showed you earlier with cylinder cutouts. We'll start with cylinder cutout with 1, 2, 3 active. So this is on the opposite bank of the EGR loop. And you can see the point. It's the green triangle on your screen. It does show 17% fuel savings over the thermal management baseline with elevated turbine outlet temperature. And if you look down at the normalized exhaust flow rate on the bottom, we're cutting our exhaust flow rate almost in half, not quite in half. It's not down to the CDA level, but it's getting close. So, I mean, this is a potential stay warm strategy at an idle condition. It doesn't have the fuel consumption benefit of CDA, right? So CDA gives an additional 23% fuel savings over cylinder cutout. Said another way, CDA is 28% more efficient than cylinder cutout with 1, 2, 3 active, but there is a marked fuel savings. The reason why this cylinder cutout strategy performs pretty well is in all of the cylinder cutout cases, we're squeezing that VGT way down in order to get our exhaust gas temperature elevated, okay? And so with cylinder cutout 1, 2, 3 active, you can actually open up the EGR even more, the EGR valve more, to flow more recirculated gas. And you have to do that in order to meet NOx because you are your EGR is being diluted by the air pumping cylinders, okay? That actually reduces the exhaust manifold back pressure and helps with your with the fuel efficiency of the engine. Looking at the other bank of cylinders, so cylinder cutout with 4, 5, 6 active, and you see it circled here in red on the TOT BSSC plot. It has similar exhaust temperatures to CDA with 3 cylinders firing, but it shows high exhaust flow rates and fuel consumptions. And I mean, really, there's no reason why you'd ever want to do this because you could ultimately just hop over there on that trade-off line between your 6-cylinder fuel-efficient mode and your TM baseline and be, you know, for equivalent exhaust flow and TOT, you could be more efficient. So CDA 4, 5, 6 active is not a very attractive stay-warm strategy. Putting these cylinder cutout points onto the that normalized heat transfer plot we talked about earlier, really you can disregard that cylinder cutout 4, 5, 6 active point, but take a look at that. The green point, you can see the CDA performs better, but cylinder cutout doesn't do too bad of a job. However, what doesn't show through here is CDA at 2 CF is 28% more efficient than cylinder cutout with 1, 2, 3 active, right? And then just to make sure I do my due diligence and show you that we are emissions constrained for all those cylinder cutout points as well. Okay, so this is just a PM NOx plot 1-to-1. You can see we're constrained on emissions. So the efficiency variation of CDA and cylinder cutout and conventional operation really comes down to your open cycle efficiency, so the efficiency of your gas exchange process. And that's pretty typical for all of EVA strategies, right? Where we're fundamentally affecting the way the gases are moving through the engine, and that manifests in open cycle efficiency. So the typical trend is, and open cycle efficiency is heavily dependent on your pressure differential across the engine, right? That dictates your pumping loop. And so on the left plot there, you can see the trend, right? Lower delta P across your engine, results in reduced BSFC via the plot on the right, higher open cycle efficiency. So if we populate these plots with the actual data points, the trend is pretty clear on why the efficiency variation happens for your conventional and cylinder cutout and CDA points. Of course, the delta P really comes down to the pumping loop, and at the bottom plot, you can see a log P log V diagram for CDA and cylinder cutout, and cylinder cutout has larger pumping loops in the active cylinders, not to mention it's got other, you know, cutout cylinders that still have pumping loops. They're still pumping gas as well, and so that's why cylinder cutout is not as efficient as CDA. So populating the cylinder cutout portion of the table a little bit more, cylinder cutout with 1, 2, 3 active has better stay warm performance than the conventional thermal management operation. So it gets that green check mark. It does not have better warm up performance, but it does have lower fuel consumption, engine out, NOx, and PM. It doesn't perform as well as CDA, but it does perform better than the thermal management baseline. Cylinder cutout 4, 5, 6 does not. And another point that I didn't show you was that we did try was cylinder cutout with 2, 3, 4 active. And it's really sits somewhere in the middle between 1, 2, 3 active, 4, 5, 6 active. So just to stay out of the weeds, I didn't show that, but it's still summarized here. But one more side path I want to take you down has to do with the turbocharger setup here, or what we're doing with the VGT. So if you look at the points that I've showed you, and these are the VGT of all the position of all those points, you can see there's the cylinder cutout points up in the top right are all at 100% closed VGT position, along with our thermal management baseline. Whereas CDA strategies have a little more open VGT position, and especially with two cylinders firing. So a logical question is, you know, that seems to maybe be advantageous for CDA. So how would all of these strategies compare with, say, fixed geometry turbocharger? And so that's what we looked at. We use it with our industry's collaborators. We were advised on how to emulate a fixed geometry turbocharger with this VGT and going to the correct VGT position. And so we looked at all of the data points in the green circle there and recalibrated accordingly and with that VGT constraint. And let's see what we get. So similar format plot, different data points now, right? Because all these have asterisks because they have open VGT positions. When you open a VGT up, as you probably can guess, the BSFC does reduce. So we are more efficient. However, the thermal management performance really drops off for cylinder cutout, those triangles. You can see we're at pretty low turbine outlet temperatures, and it drops off for the thermal management baseline as well. However, CDA maintains its thermal management performance even without the exhaust manifold pressure control that the VGT allows. That's pretty attractive. It maintains turbine outlet temperature. You can see cylinder 2CF firing for CDA still has greater than 250 degree turbine outlet temperature and has reduced exhaust flow. So CDA maintains its thermal management performance without the need of that VGT control. We are also, just worth noting, unable to constrain NOx for the cylinder cutout 1, 2, 3 active because of the dilution of the active cylinders in 4, 5, 6. You couldn't flow enough EGR without the VGT control in order to constrain your emissions. So we can add another row to the table, and that's looking at exhaust manifold pressure control. TM baseline gets an X there, right? Because that's a key part of the baseline strategy is squeezing that VGT. And so if you remove that, it does not perform as well. CDA does not require that exhaust manifold pressure control to have to get its good results, fuel efficient thermal management results, and whereas cylinder cutout does. So it gets X's as well. So to summarize, both CDA and cylinder cutout 1, 2, 3 active demonstrate improved stay warm thermal management performance at curb idle compared to the baseline thermal management strategy. CDA with two cylinders firing reduces fuel consumption over the baseline by 40% while maintaining TOT, turbine outlet temperatures, above 250 Celsius. CDA is 28% more fuel efficient than cylinder cutout 1, 2, 3 active at curb idle with similar thermal management performance. And we're talking greater than 250 degrees Celsius turbine outlet temperature and reduced exhaust flow. But I also showed you how CDA performance is more robust to manifold and EGR configuration than cylinder cutout. We had sort of a dream scenario for cylinder cutout there that we hypothesized, and it turns out we did when it came to 1, 2, 3 active. CDA does not require exhaust manifold pressure control to maintain thermal management performance, whereas cylinder cutout and conventional operation, they both do. So with that, I want to thank you for your time this morning, and happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thanks, Cody. That was a great comparison of technology versus a technique. So I learned something new today. Thank you. So now is your opportunity to engage with our panel of experts here. So if you haven't already done so, please use the submit a question area in your screen here to send in a question, and we will get to as many of them as we have time for. We do have some questions that have already flowed in based on your presentation, Cody. So why don't we go ahead and get into it here. So the first question, are there any engine architecture changes that would improve the performance of cylinder cutout compared to CDA? And Cody, why don't you take that one?
Engine architecture changes. You know, I don't think so. When we started looking into cylinder cutout, we hypothesized that we may have had if there was ever going to be a scenario where cylinder cutout would give CDA a run for its money, it would be with that split manifold architecture and the EGR pulling off of one side, because you could do some creative things with the gas exchange process. And so I'm gonna say no. I don't know of any engine architecture change that would improve the performance of CDA or of cylinder cutout compared to CDA.
Jim or Greg, anybody want to tag on to that one?
Tony, this is Greg. I agree with Cody.
Okay, great. Thanks. Okay, next question. Cody, can you elaborate on the NVH characteristics of cylinder cutout in comparison to CDA in conventional operation?
Yeah, that's it.
You didn't talk about NVH. Yeah, sorry.
Right. No, I'm happy to give a few insights on it. So we looked at NVH on a variety of scenarios, including cylinder cutout. To summarize, right, so you still have all six cylinders doing the compression events, and so you still get that third order content similar to conventional operation. However, because there's only combustion in three of the cylinders, you do get an increase in 1.5 order, so half frequency of what you normally would be for your normal firing events. So in that way, cylinder cutout's frequency domain is sort of a mixture between conventional and CDA. It's been shown that CDA's NVH is acceptable, and so I would assume that cylinder cutout would also be acceptable.
Okay. Next question here. We're going to give you a chance to grab a drink of water or something. Let's take a break. So, Greg, why don't you take this one for us here? Do you expect the results that we've seen from cylinder deactivation and cylinder cutout to be scalable or applicable to larger 13-liter and 15-liter engines, because this was done on a 6.7-liter engine, I believe, right?
Yes, that's correct. Tony, thank you for the question. Yeah, I do expect that you would see the same trends in larger on-road engines. Of course, you know, what I'm hoping is that to the extent they may not have already, you know, our colleagues in industry will be, I hope, doing some cylinder deactivation work with their own engines at idle and low load conditions of relevance to them, and you know, also then doing tests on their engine and their test cells in an apples to apples comparison with cylinder cutout is actually fairly straightforward, because, you know, in cylinder cutout you're just shutting off the fueling, right? So I think ultimately, you know, if you will, their engine and, you know, in their testing facilities, they can do this comparison, you know, in the same way we did. So my hope is that coming out of the webinar series, they'll be encouraged to look at CDA and, you know, also consider some of the other VVA strategies. And, you know, they can see what they get, right? But short answer is yes, I expect these results to scale, and like Cody, I think, said very well, you know, the CDA results at and around idle, really, they don't depend on the air handling. You know, we are using high pressure EGR, but we're not requiring an exhaust throttle, we're not requiring exhaust manifold pressure control, and so because of the nature of the gas exchange with cylinder deactivation, you know, what other air handling actuators you have matters less, because you're not gonna need to lean on them, right? The answer we got for cylinder cutout, like you know, Cody said, is maybe the best case scenario given the layout of the architecture on our engine. But again, everybody, you know, needs to work for and get their own answer with their own engine. So thank you.
Thanks, Greg. We did have a comment, and I do want to apologize to everyone. The slide formats were not good today, so again, I apologize. The PowerPoint versions, I'm sorry, the PDF version of these slides that are available in the resources area, you can download those. I encourage everyone to download those. They're fine. The format is exactly the way that they should be. So I apologize for what you probably saw on screen today with the overlapping fonts and text boxes, but PDF versions that you can download look fine. So back to the Q&A here. So Cody, you showed a brief description of the charge trapping strategies for CDA. Combustion charge trapping had a higher peak pressure after deactivation than the cycle before. Why was that?
Yeah, thanks, Tony. So that was an interesting outcome of that charge trapping study. I don't know that it will have a big impact, right? It is interesting that for combustion charge trapping, you can get higher peak pressure than during the actual combusting cycle. The reason, and it's a really simple reason, once you just draw out your PV diagram, even an idealized PV diagram, and you can see, if you think about in your head, an idealized dual cycle, right? If you have all constant volume combustion, then combustion charge trapping, the assuming a perfect gas spring, your max pressure will be equivalent to that of the cycle before. However, if you start getting more constant pressure combustion happening, then whenever that piston follows back up and recompresses that gas, it will, you know, you're compressing at an even higher volume than the combustion happened at, and that's what causes the effect.
Okay. Another question on charge trapping, some interest here from the audience. What is best for entering CDA, fresh charge trapping or combustion charge trapping?
Yeah, in short, what we saw on our particular engine, when we did a pretty thorough study of both of these, when it comes to performance, it didn't matter because the trapping strategy, the pressures converge after only a few rotations of the engine. And so it didn't matter. There might be some other ways why one would be better than the other that our colleagues or Eaton, I'm sure, would be poised to answer. But from our standpoint, there was no difference.
Okay. Jim, question for you here. In the previous webinars, CDA was clearly shown to be a good method for keeping the after-treatment system warm. Is there a strategy with CDA for getting the after-treatment hot during cold operation?
Thanks, Tony. That's a great question. And clearly, you know, Cody and Greg have shown the stay-warm capability of CDA. I'll remind you back to the presentation that Chris Sharp gave in one of the previous webinars, and that was on a 15-liter engine. But CDA is really good at increasing the temperature, yet it decreases the flow. So the strategy that Chris shared was elevated idle speed for get hot. And so you're using CDA to increase the temperature, and you're using the engine speed to increase the flow rate, the combination of which gives you higher exhaust enthalpy to heat up the aft treatment system. And that's been shown on at least the 15-liter engine to be a very good get hot strategy for that size engine. So I'm convinced that, you know, CDA is a great stay warm technology, and at least in the case of the 15-liter engine with elevated idle speed, a great get hot. Thanks for the question.
Sure. A couple more for you here, Cody. What is the fundamental reason why CDA offers better fuel economy than cylinder cutout?
Thanks, Tony. Yeah, it comes down to pumping work. CDA has lower pumping work in the active cylinders, not to mention there is no pumping work in the deactivated cylinders for CDA, whereas in a cylinder cutout, those inactive cylinders, those cutout cylinders, those all still have pumping loops. So in short, cylinder cutout has more pumping losses than CDA.
Gotcha. Okay. Like two more here, it looks like. And then I think we're going to switch over to our guest speaker. So, Cody, can you describe the interface for the VVA system and how was the deactivation controlled?
Yeah, sure. So the interface for the VVA system, it's a homebrew system, right? So this is not meant to be a production VVA system. It's meant for apples to apples comparisons of various VVA technologies. And so it's very flexible, but perhaps not, you know, not plug and play. It's all centered around a DSpace system, rapid prototyping system. And so behind the scenes there is a Simulink program doing all the valve strategies and interfacing with the ECM via the open architecture. So it's DSpace, it's MATLAB Simulink being auto-coded to a DSpace that's controlling the system.
Okay. Let's see. And I think we've got time for one more here. And Greg, if you could take this one for us. How do you expect the benefits of CDA to vary with modern and next-gen after-treatment systems?
Thanks, Tony. I'm happy to take that one. I believe they'll be complementary. So there is a lot of exciting work that has gone on, continues to go on, and modern diesel engine after-treatment. These systems still, you know, require that catalyst get to temperature and stay at temperature. They also require that when we are injecting urea upstream of an SCR, of which we could have one or two, for instance, in next-gen systems, we need to be able to get the gas temperatures up above approximately 190 degrees, per my understanding. So we want the gas going into the catalyst to be, the SCR to be elevated when we inject urea, and we want the catalysts themselves to get to temperature and stay at temperature in as fuel efficient a manner as possible. So our ability to get the after treatments warmer and keep them warm may get easier as we move to next generation systems, you know, for instance, close coupled SCR catalysts and other manifestations of, you know, a similar idea, as well as we maybe further improve the basically the heat transfer characteristics of these systems so that more heat goes into the after treatment. All that said, you know, the, you know, projections are indicating that, you know, we're going to need to do something both with the engine and with the after treatment to meet you know, future regulations that that we know are coming by way of the California Air Resources Board, and that are likely coming by way of the EPA. And so we can marry these technologies in a very direct way. So the strategy like what Professor Allen was talking about today, and that has been the subject matter of our webinar, cylinder deactivation, brings us benefit. And by itself, it's worth implementing, even if we were doing that with today's after treatment. Likewise, there would be a benefit to implementing, you know, more advanced strategies for after treatment, even if we weren't doing something with the valve train and the engine. But it sure looks like we're going to need to combine them. And the good news is they complement one another. So, I you know, basically the short answer. Sorry, I'm a professor. I talk too much sometimes. but they're complementary, and you're likely going to need both.
Awesome. Thanks, Greg. Appreciate it.
All right, so we've come to the guest speaker section, and I'd like to introduce you to Fabiano Contarin. Fabiano is the product director for commercial vehicle valve actuation at Eaton. His focus is on product strategy development and industrialization of VVA and engine brake systems for commercial vehicles. Prior to this, he held other roles in Eaton in engineering, sales, and program management. He holds a bachelor's in the science and mechanical engineering from Politecnico di Torino. Fabiano, welcome to the webinar series, and go ahead and take it away.
Sure. Thank you, Tony, and good morning, good afternoon to everyone. Thanks for the kind introduction, Tony. No need to speak more about me. So what I want to do first is to give a big thank you to all the keynote speakers and the panelists who shared their knowledge in this webinar. That was super interesting information that we have listened to. Also, another big thank you to Jim and Tony for having organized all of this. I'm really glad to have a chance to wrap up this series because I really think that CDA technology has a great potential, as the presenters explained us so well. And also, this is a key product in our portfolio. Now, the next slide, if you can. Okay, so, CDA is not new, right? So CDA has been in production for nearly two decades. And Eaton is definitely a leading supplier of CDA systems with millions of pieces supplied every year. But this is for passenger car gasoline engines, and the main purpose of CDA there is to mitigate the inefficiency of throttling. Now, it's really intriguing for an engineer, as I am, to see how CDA makes sense also on larger diesel engines, which do not have a throttle, but need the exhaust gases to be hot to keep the aftertreatment system efficient. And the way I see it, the people who spoke in these five webinars are really pioneers of this new application of CDA, as some of their work started 10 years ago, about. Okay, so what I would like to do next is to share with you my takeaways from these five webinars. And I would like to apologize in advance to the speakers for oversimplifying the messages. In the first webinars, we heard presentations from Tom Reinhardt and Chris Sharp from Southwest Research, presenting their work in investigating viability of the CARB ultra-low NOx targets, as well as the technologies needed to meet those. This work was done on a Cummins 15-liter engine. Tom Reinhardt focused on CDA and NVH, and every time there is a discussion about the challenges of implementing CDA in an engine, NVH is the first topic that comes up. Tom gave us very good news on this front, explaining how carefully selecting the number of acting cylinders depending on speed and load, we can achieve vibration levels which are comparable or lower than normal engine operation in six-cylinder firing, both on the FTP cycle as well as on the low-low cycle. Chris Sharp explained how upgrading the aftertreatment system of this engine, as well as optimizing the calibration, is possible to achieve or get close with the low NOx target, but with a big penalty of CO2. When adding CDA to the recipe, the CO2 impact is heavily reduced, with a 3% reduction on the FTP cycle and 5% reduction over the low-low cycle. Also, for me, an interesting takeaway from Chris Sharp's presentation is that CDA is not necessarily only a keep warm strategy, but can also be a get hot strategy if combined with elevated idle. This is what Jim was mentioning a few minutes ago. Now, the last three webinars were presented by Bruno Alioshi, Greg Shaver, and Cody Allen, and was about their work at Purdue for investigating multiple VDA strategies as ways to reduce NOx and CO2, and the engine used for this work is the Cummins 6.7 liter engine, so considerably smaller engine than the work done by Southwest Research. Now, it was interesting to notice that the results presented by Bruno Yoshi were quite consistent. Consistent with those presented by Southwest Research, compared to a calibration-based thermal management strategy, the CDA technology was proven to provide a 3.4% benefit on the FTP cycle, comparing very well with the 3% I mentioned before on the 50 liter. A 9% benefit on the Orange County bus cycle, and a 4 to 35% benefit on the trade cycle. Professor Greg Chen.
Fabiano, I don't know if it's me, but I think we might have lost you.
So, Tony, in the spirit of time, I could go ahead and continue.
Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead, Jen. Thank you.
So, as Fabiano was talking, Dr. Joshi talked about 4 to 35% savings on the drayage cycle. The 4% is really on the on-highway, which matched up really well to the FTP savings of 3.4%. Whereas, as you go to lower load operation, that's where they were able to save the 35%. So the more time you spend at low load, the more fuel you save. Greg Shaver did a great job talking about, it looks like Fabiano's back. So we'll hand it back to Fabiano for Greg.
Thank you. Thank you, Jim, for supporting. So yeah, I don't know what happened, but I'm back. So yeah, so I was talking about the work done by Greg Shaver about comparison between a CDA and other VDA strategy. And my takeaway is that definitely CDA is the best option when it comes to idle and low load. And just to leave you with a number, the benefit versus a calibration-based thermal management strategy is 41% at loaded idle. And together with the CO2 benefit, also the engine out NOx and soot is reduced by 50%. That's really interesting news. Finally, Cody Allen, the presentation was given today, so there is not much need to give a summary of that. But what I take out of it is that when compared to a cylinder cutout strategy, which in principle is easier to implement as it doesn't require CDA hardware, CDA provides a very significant advantage, which can be quantified in 23% less CO2, and also doesn't require the control of the exhaust manifold pressure, and can be combined with a high efficiency turbo. Okay, so lots of good data proving that CDA really can be key in meeting the future regulation for both NOx and CO2. Since I'm representing the team who is going to put in production these things, the message I would like to leave you with is that the Eaton CDA technology that has been used for most of this work is not only good for research and labs, but really is ready for production. Building on more than 20 years of experience in the passenger car CDA, Eaton has been developing and testing commercial vehicle CDA for more than 5 years. Now, what I'm showing you in this picture is renders from our technology demonstrator engine, where CDA was applied to multiple engine architecture. You can see a dual overhead cam, a single overhead cam, and an overhead valve engine. And also, it has been combined with other variable valve actuation functions, as well as, of course, engine brake and hydraulic lash adjustment on top of it. We see a lot of interest in CDA as well as VDA in the commercial vehicle business, and this interest is for sure triggered by the upcoming regulations in North America, in Europe, and also in China. So we are cooperating with several customers in the development of this product. In case you're interested to learn more about our product offering, I will be very happy to be contacted by you, and you can use my contact information that you see on the first slides of my presentation. And with this, I would like to thank all of you, all of the contributors to this webinar, as well as the audience for the kind attention and questions, and look forward to hear from you. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Fabiano. So I will say the same thing. I want to thank all of our panel of experts for sharing the knowledge that they have done over the series of five webinars. If you missed one of the webinars, or if you want to go back and watch one again, we'll be sending out an email to all of those who have registered with links to the series. And be sure to check out eaton.com/engine solutions for all the latest information on Eaton cylinder deactivation. Thanks for watching and have a great day.